In the last video, I gave an introduction to algorithm analysis. Today, we're going to discuss asymptotic notation. We mentioned last time that an algorithm's rate or order of growth is important. Determining the exact runtime isn't usually worth the effort. Instead, what does the runtime do as the input size gets very large? We call this the asymptotic efficiency of the algorithm. Remember from insertion sort, the leading coefficient in lower order terms fell away and the runtime was dominated by n squared as the input size increased. In this video, I'll discuss different types of asymptotic notation, namely theta, O or big O, and omega or big omega. One note before we begin, asymptotic notation actually applies to functions. We've derived a simplified runtime function for worst case insertion sort, and we use the notation on the function. Before I get into specifics, I want to summarize how each notation binds our runtime function. Theta notation is an upper and lower bound. Big O notation is only an upper bound. And big omega notation is only a lower bound. First, let's look at theta notation. I'll start by properly defining it. This definition comes from Introduction to Algorithms, my main source, which is linked in the description. We say that theta of the function g of n means that there is f of n such that exist positive constants c1, c2, and n0, where 0 is less than or equal to c1 times g of n, which is less than or equal to f of n, which is less than or equal to c2 times g of n, for all n greater than or equal to n0. Remember that when we're analyzing algorithms, n is the input size. This means that g of n is an asymptotically tight bound for f of n. That formula is a lot to take in. I think it's easier to see graphically. Note that for all n greater than n0, f of n is sandwiched between c1 times g of n and c2 times g of n. n0 is the minimum possible value, but we could also use a larger value. One final point is that f of n must be non-negative for large values of n. Let's bring back our worst case function for insertion sort and fill in some constants. I'll choose 1/2, 2, and 4. Let's show how this function equals theta of n squared. Theta is actually a set of functions, but we often write it in this manner as an equality. Going back to our definition, let's plug in each side of our inequalities, c1 n squared and c2 n squared. We need to find the positive values of c1, c2, and n0 so that this holds true. Freeing up some screen real estate, let's first divide by n squared, resulting in this. Let's look at each side of this inequality individually. Starting with the left-hand side, we know that when c1 is 1/2, the inequality holds true for all values of n greater than or equal to 1. On the right-hand side, when c2 is 1, the inequality holds true for all values of n greater than or equal to 6. Please pause the video here if you want to review that math. Thus, by choosing c1 is 1/2, c2 is 1, and n0 is 6, our function equals theta of n squared. It's perfectly legitimate to choose other constants. It's important, however, that we find some constants that exist. Let's move on to O notation, often referred to as big O notation. We say that big O of g of n means that there is a function f of n such that there exists positive constants c and n0, where 0 is less than or equal to f of n, which is less than or equal to c times g of n, for all n greater than or equal to n0. Again, when we're analyzing algorithms, n is our input size. Big O implies that f of n is asymptotically upper bound by g of n. This is what O notation looks like graphically. After some value n0 and some choice of c, f of n is upper bound by c times g of n. One observation between theta and big O we can make is that when we say f of n is equal to theta of g of n, this also implies that f of n is equal to big O of g of n. We can conclude this because theta is more strict than big O. Theta provides an upper and lower bound, whereas big O is just an upper bound. Big O is usually the choice for algorithm analysis because we can use it as an upper bound for the worst case running time of an algorithm, as well as for every input, not just the worst case, since we're looking only at upper bound. More on this at the end. Let's take a look at the final asymptotic notation we'll cover in this video, omega notation. We'll formally define it as omega, or big omega, of g of n means that there is f of n such that there exists positive constants c and n0, where 0 is less than or equal to c times g of n, which is less than or equal to f of n, for all n greater than or equal to n0. Again, n is input size. Omega notation provides an asymptotically lower bound for f of n. Graphically, here's what this looks like. The runtime of f of n is at least a constant times g of n for any n past n0. This chart sums up the different types of bounds we saw in this video. One final point before we end. Remember that there are different types of runtime: best case, average case, and worst case. It is important to be clear about the type of runtime you are analyzing when using these notations. Let's bring back insertion sort to demonstrate. For example, it's perfectly legitimate to say the worst case runtime of insertion sort is theta of n squared. However, you can't say that the runtime for every input is theta of n squared because theta has upper and lower bounds. And we saw in the last video, when the array is already sorted, its best case runtime was linear. It is, however, legitimate to say that the runtime with no modifiers, or for every input of insertion sort, is big O of n squared, since there is only an upper bound. And you can also say the runtime of insertion sort is big omega of n, since omega is only a lower bound. These examples, of course, are when n is significantly large. Because we're most interested in worst case, big O is often chosen because it's an upper bound. Thank you for watching. I hope this video helps you on your computer science journey.